Hello, everyone. You can hear me now, I guess. I'm Jessica Flack. I'm a professor at the Santa Fe Institute. I work on collective computation and collective intelligence, which I'm told is the reason why I'm introducing this panel on intelligence today. Intelligence is one of those topics that I think we all think we understand. It certainly concerns us in our everyday lives, but it's actually a heavily debated topic among scientists, and there isn't much agreement about what counts as intelligent. And I think you're going to hear a lot about that today, that disagreement. We have several programs at SFI related to intelligence, and the panel sort of gives a sense of the range. And one of the reasons why there's little agreement about what intelligence is because it not only occurs in individual heads in our brains, but it also is a feature of collectives. That's the type of intelligence that I work on, in groups, collective intelligence. And it occurs in, we hope, one day, in artificial intelligence. And so today, on today's panel, we have over here, starting with on the left, Melanie Mitchell, who's a professor at SFI, and her expertise is, in fact, artificial intelligence. And in particular, she works on understanding and what it means to, how we're going to achieve general artificial intelligence, what it means to have general artificial intelligence. And next is John Krakauer, who's on our external faculty and at Johns Hopkins. And John is a neuroscientist, and he's on the panel because he's one of the only people on the panel who actually does experiments on intelligence, as he just told me. on individual intelligence in brains, John does. Specifically, he works on motor control. So you might not have thought of that in the context of intelligence, but he'll have a lot, I think, to say about that tonight. And then we have Brendan Tracy, who is now at DeepMind. He used to be a postdoc at SFI, and he works on artificial intelligence too, but he's in the business of sort of implementing intelligence in neural networks and machine learning. Next is Orit, who's at UC Boulder in the computer science department. She's a biophysicist by training. Were you ever a postdoc at SFI? No, right?
I'm sorry?
You were never an SFI postdoc, right?
No, sadly no.
An honorary one. And Orit works on intelligence in collectives, and honeybee swarms and social insects. And so that's the collective perspective tonight. And finally, we have David Krakauer, who is, of course, SFI president, and who's a primary collaborator of mine. We do together a collective computation work, but David does quite a bit of work on intelligence generally, and he's here to represent the perspective of sort of intelligence across scales, intelligence not just in human brains or in artificial systems or in honeybee collectives, but also in cells. So he studies, as he says, intelligence all the way down, and he often thinks about, in addition to intelligence, the origins and evolution of stupidity.
Thank you.
So with that, I turn over to the panel.
Fantastic. We good?
Some of the microphones need to be turned on.
Turned on. Wonderful. On.
Good.
Yeah. So this is a panel. It's sort of growing, you know, because it's on intelligence. Everyone wanted to be on the panel, and I had to explain it's not about being intelligent. It's about talking about it. But the main point of this one is theories of intelligence. Like, do we need them? And I'm just going to make some comments, and I'm going to open it up to what everyone thinks it is. Not asking for a definition, because that's very dull, but how they think about it. And they're all rather different, actually, so we can have a good argument. But just to make the point that, you know, early on, you know, intelligence was that thing measured by IQ tests. You go back and look at IQ tests, and the last thing they are is intelligent. Because they ask factual questions. Who was the second president of the United States? And so that kind of thing. So knowledge was intelligence. And then you get this quote from Richard Feynman, who I mentioned earlier. He says, what I cannot create, I do not understand. So actually there, knowledge was the opposite. I want to be denied knowledge to show you how intelligent I am. A very, very different perspective. And so most curious people will say, don't tell me the answer. I want to work it out for myself. That sort of thing. One of the things that will come up, I think, here are differences on skill and expertise, how we've made dichotomies between athletics, for example, and analytical performance. And as John likes to say, you know, I mean, I don't know if you say it, but you should. He'll say something like, you know, you don't buy a season ticket to the math department, but you spend an awful lot of money watching people move. And so that's something to work about. Then there's the whole individual versus collective, and Norit has done beautiful work actually visualizing. It's one of my favorite movies. Yeah, three-dimensional movies that look like holograms of fireflies in space to collect the kinds of data to look at other kinds of intelligence. And then, of course, the whole debate about deep learning and machine learning and whether we've built things that are just idiot savants that are essentially exactly what Feynman hated, highly knowledgeable, feign intelligence, or, as Brendan might claim, no, actually they are intelligent, they're just a different kind of intelligence. And so I just, starting at the end there, is that meaningful, that thing? Starting at the end, Manny, why don't you, we'll just work down and sort of say a few words about how you think about this phenomenon.
So, is this on? Yes. But so my work is on artificial intelligence mostly, although I'm inspired by biological intelligence. I think we, you know, there's this idea that we've made huge progress over the last couple of decades in AI. You know, we now have all these AI systems that can do all these things for us that seem more and more intelligent. And we've been told often in the newspaper that very soon we're going to have human-level intelligence and it's going to take all our jobs away. Well, there's an issue with talking about intelligence that we use words to describe our intelligence, such as knowledge, learning, reasoning, thinking, understanding, etc., and we apply these words to the things that machines can do, but it turns out that when we, even though we might use a word like learning, you've probably heard of machine learning, the word learning there means something very different than it means in, say, human learning or even in animal learning. And that there's many things that seem to, that we know to correlate with learning in biological systems. So we often assume that that same thing will correlate with learning in artificial systems, like being able to take something you learned and use it in some new situation. But it turns out often those correlations aren't there for machines. So we often tend to overestimate what machines can do, simply because of the language we use to talk about it is very anthropomorphic. So I'll stop there.
There are so many things to say that one ends up saying nothing, but...
It is.
Oh, yeah. So I'm going to just say a few things about three things. One is, artificial general intelligence really means human intelligence, but it's very interesting that David sort of hinted at it when he mentioned IQ, that in the triad of human intelligence, which we are obsessed with, hence Go, Atari, and now large language models, these are human benchmarks. So we are interested in human intelligence, and Melanie sort of talked about things like inference and reasoning and language and knowledge, which is still a huge problem. But we don't really talk about human intelligence. The New York Times will tell us about a fungus that's intelligent, a jumping spider that's intelligent. David's going to talk about cells being intelligent. So it's very okay to talk about intelligence in the animal kingdom in general, and it's certainly okay to talk about machine intelligence, right? But human intelligence, not really. It's a little suspect. It's got a poor history. And yes, we're obsessed with benchmarks that are human, but there's somehow we don't want to talk about that, which I think is a huge error. Second, just to relate to what happened in the first panel today, where they were talking about how time was taken away from the psychologists and the philosophers and given over to the physicists. It's exactly what's happening with intelligence. There was, in fact, a debate at ICML in Baltimore earlier this year where there was basically a debate, well, let's just leave intelligence and AGI to the engineers. We'll get there. The scientists should just stop worrying about it, somewhat like the psychologists and the philosophers should stop worrying about time. Let's leave it to the physicists, right? And then today from Chris, we just heard about sort of scaling laws. You know, are there sort of general principles? And that's very much what I think the AI community and the neuroscience community hope, is that if you have an animal model, whether it's C. elegans, whether it's a mouse, you know, that somehow there'll be some general principles of intelligence that will scale up to the human version, right? Same thing with machines, although there was just a recent on Twitter today What are all the things that mice still do better than any AI, right? Which is sort of interesting. So in other words, I think the point here is there diversity of intelligence? Are there general principles underlying it? Can we get there through extrapolation? Should we now leave this to the physicists and the engineers and the computer scientists? But what I would argue here is that there's this bizarre problem of human intelligence, and we don't know what to do with it, right? And I just think that's interesting, and it's like Chris's answer to me, we're probably never going to be able to predict human intelligence from machines or animals.
Yeah, I think it's a really interesting question. So I have this, I guess Melanie and I share this, but coming from, like, basically coming from the SFI side, and then for me at least, I don't come from a computer science background originally, so it's been weird kind of then being embedded in a full kind of computer science space where things that I think are totally normal at SFI to say that humans have intelligence, but so do animals, and maybe collective intelligence is a thing. Like, these, I think, are starting to progress more and more, and I think it's really interesting actually to talk about this skill versus intelligence, where if we look at kind of the history of AI, right, you rewind time, I don't know, 100 years, and, well, someone who could play chess, like, that's a really intelligent person. And then in the 80s, we see a computer that can play chess, and we're actually kind of disappointed in the intelligence that seems to be embodied in the system that can do it. And now all of a sudden, well, okay, maybe that's not really the mark of intelligence. Maybe being able to talk is, and we start getting these, like, first of all, terrible chatbots, and now, as you mentioned, these large language models that are getting increasingly impressive, and we're still like, well, I mean, they're starting to get there, but they're also not really what we mean by intelligence. And also, but, and then again, we see, right, there are things that in 1910, you'd have said, well, these are the things that robots are first going to be able to do, like sew a quilt from scratch, right? And they're still very far off from doing that, even though we have all these incredible systems now. And so I think kind of definitionally intelligence is something about being able to adapt and learn really, really quickly to new things, and also being able to sort of extrapolate from one problem to another and seeing the commonalities. But I think also, I don't know, a lot of these newer systems and seeing where their successes are and where their failures are also makes me sort of even more strongly believe that things like skills, I find them harder to pull apart now than even a couple of years ago before seeing all these advances. So if you take something like learning a musical instrument, you have the high level, we'll call it the high level music expressiveness and taking things like emotion and trying to embed them in. But in order to even really get there, you kind of need to hammer home things like skills and being able to jump arpeggios and things like that. And if you haven't built up these base levels of capability, you can't end up producing the higher levels. And so I find it more and more difficult to tear these two things apart, where a couple of years ago I thought it was kind of obvious that, sure, being skilled is very different than being intelligent. But as I see the progress in the field, I become less and less convinced that that's true.
Okay, and what I'm going to say is probably related to my background in physics. And when I think about intelligence, I think it's a little bit more physical. It's like mechanical intelligence, how animals sometimes have this intuitive understanding of their environment, or their body evolved in a certain way to be able to deal with different environments. And that's the second thing, the environment. I think that intelligence is really context dependent. Animals, agents, they can appear really intelligent in certain contexts and certain environments, and can appear really unintelligent in other environments. And this is especially important when thinking about collective intelligence, where the boundary between the environment and the individual, or the superorganism in that case, becomes a little bit more vague. An individual within a superorganism might be interacting externally with the environment, it might be interacting with another individual within that group, and that's the kind of area that I'm really interested in.
So let's now talk about theories of intelligence, because, so one of the big distinctions, and we should just debate this, and I'm not going to put this in any order, people can jump in as long as we're all more or less fairly distributed in time. We used to have symbolic theories, logic. It's Brendan's point. We thought that mathematical reasoning was the one. That's how we should express it. So if we express our theory of intelligence in logic, we're somehow closer to the object. And then we have these new models, which are statistical inferential models, massive, billions of parameters, the opposite of Occam's razor, the opposite of parsimony. That, in other words, everything that we think in science is bad science, in a way, right? And there are theories for these kinds of theories of names, rather, the Bayes brain, the Bayesian brain. There are new names for new theories of intelligence in these new high-dimensional systems. Just curious to go around a little bit. Are there any theories of intelligence that we think are plausible today? Or do we just have lots of models, and it's a kind of cabinet of curiosities, and we're making Frankensteins that are doing interesting things, but we're doing sort of 18th century, 19th century engineering. We're not doing 20th century mathematical physics.
Yes, so a lot of people have, at least in artificial intelligence, likened artificial intelligence research today to alchemy, that you just try some stuff, see what happens, try some other stuff, trying to combine different things to get lead to turn into gold. I think neuroscience has some of the same characteristics. Because we don't really know what the right macro variables are, the other problem is that I think, unlike something like gravity or other basic things that people build theories around, intelligence isn't a real thing. There is no such thing as intelligence. There's many aspects of behavior and computation that we might call intelligent, but I don't think there's any kind of universal sort of unity around it.
I'd like to just to add to that a bit, I think that what Melanie said is right, but I guess I would argue a little bit that sort of maybe 5 years ago we were in the alchemy stage, and now in artificial intelligence we're starting to get the like early industrial era stage, right? Where previously we were doing some things, none of which really worked on a true intelligence scale, but a lot of kind of specific instances that were pretty good. And at least to my eyes and seeing some of these systems, we're starting to get some things that like appear intelligent. Now, I'm not trying to say that they're truly the artificial general intelligence we're hoping for, but I will say that they're, in my opinion, they're qualitatively different than what we had before, and maybe we're starting to build some tools to start seeing what kinds of properties truly emerge from these systems and emerge as we increase the scale of what they've seen and the scale of what they've built. And maybe we're at the stage where we know historically there's been this tension between kind of engineering things that work and then understanding the science of how they worked and then coming back to engineer the next thing. And we're maybe at a place where we can start that ratchet as we kind of get things that actually maybe do have some of the properties that we're hoping for, even though we're not there yet.
Can I just, before you go, John, just to make sure to get it on track, which is theory of, right? Because, so I understand Melanie's point. She's saying there's a constellation of properties that we describe as intelligence, which is fine, but it's absolutely not something like gravity. And so I just want to make sure we keep running with this idea of, is it something, therefore, that's impossible to theorize about? Or is it going to require multiplicity of theories to explain all those properties independently? Just, John, I just want to keep on that notion of, does it need a theory?
Well, first of all, I disagree with you. If you were an alien watching someone play Pac-Man, and you were at a very high level of Pac-Man, and you were the human champion was playing and getting away with Pac-Man, and the game was getting the ghosts, and the ghosts were coming after you, and a person was looking down, they go, the ghosts are intelligent, they're goal-oriented, and they're going after Pac-Man really well, and they'd look at Pac-Man and go, Pac-Man's intelligent, goal-oriented, well, I've got to get away from the ghosts, and I've got to eat the little berries, or whatever it is, right? So those are both intelligent behaviors. They are. They're goal-directed. They're flexible. They have good policies. They can manage it all over the place. Fine. The point, and to David's question, we'll probably come up, we're certainly doing it in AI with one algorithm, basically, right? And you can probably start to have a theory of flexible, intelligent control policies, whether they're in the spinal cord or whether they're in a computer. Fine. What we don't have a theory of is us up here on this panel having this conversation. Right? That's where we simply do not know. And as Joshua Bengio says, quite rightly, we haven't got a clue. Right? So that's what's interesting, is that we are beginning to understand intelligent control policies in motor systems. I can talk about skill and motor systems till the cows come home, and there are general principles arising. And I think in AI too, we talk about reinforcement learning, we talk about supervised learning, we talk about unsupervised learning, we talk about Bayesian prediction. We do have some ideas that could rise to the level of theory. No question. The real thing is that none of that, in my view, is going to suffice for what people secretly want to understand is what's language, what's reasoning, what's abductive inference in the Peircean sense. And all I'm telling you, and trust me, we haven't the slightest clue, right? So that's what's atheoretical, that's what's a gap, and Melanie's talked about it, the barrier of meaning. And then I think we are beginning to learn a lot about intelligence of all the other kinds, and I think we're getting quite good at it.
I'm not sure I really have much to add, besides that I agree with everybody here that we are in a state where there's lots of little theories or lots of little models. I'm actually curious about what you think the difference between these are. That's not a bad place to be. I personally think there's hope for higher level understanding or unification of intelligence, but I also trust John on what he just said, so I'm excited to continue the discussion.
So I really loved Chris Kempe's talk that he just gave here, and he showed us some incredible scaling laws that he called systematizing life here on Earth. I don't think we have anything like those scaling laws for anything related to intelligence. Maybe some of you will disagree with me, but that something like that, if that could happen, then that would be a kind of beginning of a theory of intelligence as a unified phenomenon. And I don't think that we have anything like that or any idea what it is that we want to measure to put on those axes for which we want to draw the straight line.
So let me just, okay, so John wants to have the argument about discontinuities in the natural world. It's not the only conversation to have, but it's one. And but let's have it, because I think that what is the problem here? The problem is most of us on this stage, I hope all of us, are evolutionary people. We don't believe we were designed by something extraterrestrial. And the evolutionary process is basically built on hill climbing, on some kind of optimization principle with fairly continuous landscapes that you climb. And if you look at almost every trait in every animal, they're shared. There's no physical trait that a chimpanzee and a human don't share, really. There's almost no gene that we don't share with a mouse. And yet, to John's point, here we are having this conversation in a symbolic, formal, semi-formal language that no other species seems to engage in, as far as we know, unless Gary Larson's right, and when they see us coming, they run. And so this question of discontinuity is very interesting. Now, we know in physics about phase transitions. We know in computation, for example, deep neural nets that weren't deep were crap. So we know scale is huge. Scale can do amazing things for us, and there are people. Melly and I just wrote a paper on this, actually, pointing out many people say, you know, all you need is scale. So let me ask this question back to everyone. Does anyone here have some clue as to what might be responsible for the discontinuity between Homo sapiens and presumably our ancestors and other biological lineages? And then we can get to the machine discontinuity after that.
Well, I mean, if you know, one of the great mysteries in neurology, and it goes back to Luria and Penfield, was the strange nature of the deficits in patients with prefrontal cortex damage. With prefrontal cortical damage. What was wrong with them, right? They didn't have motor deficits, they could engage in conversations, they could recognize their loved ones, but then they would get this breakdown in certain types of sequenced planning and reasoning in forms of inference. And if you meet these patients, they seem to be uniquely deficient in this weird extra discontinuity. It's odd. It's not the same as when they're blind or when they lose sensation or motor. All of that is shared. Their deficits look just like the deficits in our primate cousins. Okay. So if you're going to look, you're going to have to look in prefrontal cortex with perhaps part of parietal cortex. It's 3 times bigger in humans compared to chimpanzees. There's been an expansion in the striatum and the lateral cerebellum that simply goes along with it. And as far as we can tell, there's no clear, obvious microscopic difference, right? So it seems as though something's happening with scale. And then in terms of a theory, we're going to have a theory of semantic representation, a new form of representation that uncouples the object that you operate on computationally from any stimulus in the world. And that kind of representation that many people have posited, we don't know how to construct. We need a theory of that kind of representation, but if it is constructed, it's in that prefrontal cortex.
So I think John was answering the question of, like, what's the cause of this discontinuity from the sort of what causes it in the brain. The other way to ask it is the sort of why did it happen in evolution? Why did this difference in the brain come about? I don't think anyone knows, but there's a lot of speculation out there. And I think one of the more compelling answers was had to do not scaling, not with necessarily the size of our brain being the cause of intelligence, but with something like the scaling of the social groups that we had to live in, the sizes of these social groups, causing, sort of putting evolutionary pressure on needing to be able to have these kinds of cognitive abilities that John was talking about. And that, you know, that's a possibility. And so it may be that the social pressure is what makes our brains bigger, and the social aspect of intelligence is really almost all of human intelligence. We have to, you know, develop these more symbolic ways of communicating in order to deal with our social environment. And this is something that people in AI have only just begun to even grapple with, this idea that intelligence might require some kind of social interaction rather than just the old idea of the brain in the vat that's, you know, solving mathematical problems or whatever.
Just to clarify, what do you mean by discontinuity? Is it human, non-human, or human, non-human? Okay. I'm really opposing this discontinuity. I think there's certainly lots of examples in the past where we thought ourselves as human, and we misunderstood a lot of animal behavior because of that. So it's just a priori, I'm not a, you know, a neuroscientist or an expert on the human brain, so, you know, I trust you on this, but I think there's a lot of interesting intelligence in animal behavior that we just don't know about yet, and it's hard to determine whether there is discontinuity or not. Sorry to be prerequisite. Yes.
I will make a point, though, that there are many discontinuities. I mean, there are things that birds do that we can't.
Exactly.
Right? So it's not, I think, just to be clear on this point, there's nothing special about us in the sense that we have a discontinuity. Mm-hmm. It's just that there is a discontinuity that leads to a certain kind of symbolic articulation. But let me just take it to you, Eric, because it's something you work on. And I, collective intelligence, of course, many talk about culture. I didn't invent the integral, but I use it. So that's collective intelligence in humans. Fireflies don't do calculus, as far as I'm aware, but they do other things collectively. And I'm just wondering, why do you think historically we have been so individual-centric? And A, and B, what new computational capabilities come into existence in the collective context?
So I'll ask you the second question first, because I'm not sure I know the answer to the first one, but we'll get to it. I think that what comes about from a collective is the idea of emergence in some systems, where the typical saying is that the group is more of the sum of it's more than the sum of its parts. With fireflies, for example, we have a scenario where individuals are communicating with each other locally, and through these local close by interactions, they can lead to some global behavior of the entire group. For example, synchronization in fireflies, or other sources of transferring information. So that seems to me like one of the main add-ons of a collective intelligence. And yeah, why have we been centered on individuals? We are a very individualistic society, I guess, in a sense. It also really depends on where you are in the world. I'll just give a small anecdote, and it's related to synchronization. As humans, we actually synchronize a lot in social contexts. One example is clapping at the end of a concert. And it's really common in certain parts of the world. I grew up in Israel, and we do that all the time there, and not so much in the US for some reason, which is maybe a more individualistic society. Yeah, I'll stop here.
I think going back to the theory of intelligence, I think we can also somewhat draw parallels with, if we wanted to ask, like, what's a theory of an environment, right? And do we have a theory of an environment? Well, I don't really know the answer to that. However, if you look at a lot of the work that's done at SFI, by taking different viewpoints on the questions, you can end up finding that there's lots of commonality among different environments. And if you correct for various, say, availability of biomass or availability of sunlight, you can make really good predictions about new kinds of environments. So it's some kind of, theories of parts of environments. And the more you can make of these things, you can kind of stitch different pieces together. And I sort of suspect we're going to end up with the same thing with intelligence, where are we going to have a theory of intelligence? No. But maybe we can, by approaching it from the right angles, and I don't know what those are, but we can eventually kind of stitch together a number of pieces where we start to learn more. And for that, though, I think one thing that's interesting is, like, if we want to say it's a theory of intelligence, it kind of needs to span many things. And I think were we to create artificial and general intelligence, this is like a really nice data point of a very different way of doing it, right? So we know that evolution is one capability of creating human-like intelligence. Maybe there are other ways of creating human-like intelligence, and that would get us a sense of what they look like. And I think for humans, it's undeniably true that the culture is really big, and cultural learning and communication and collectives are all really important. What I'm going to be a little bit bold and say, I think we're genuinely in a case where we're at sort of maximal uncertainty right now. So the progress that these really large systems have made, in my opinion, is very strong. And while I personally do believe that it's not enough to get us all the way there, on the flip side, if you had asked me 5 years ago, like you'd said, what we're going to do is we're going to take a 10 billion parameter model, we're going to feed it the internet, and we're going to say, predict the next letter, and that's going to work. And I would have said, you're totally crazy. And so I think what we don't quite know yet where these are all going to take us, and we might actually find that there is an individualist side that gets us maybe not to all of what humans can do, but get many, many of those pieces. And I think it'll be interesting to see where we end up and where the final bottlenecks end up being for what else do we need to see as a missing piece to get to the human-like intelligence that we want.
I just want to sort of explain how much that kind of statement irritates me. it's like saying, you know, if someone had told me that we would have in a year and a half a vaccine, you know, against COVID that was 85% effective, and virologists did say this, I would never have believed it. Therefore, I'm very confident that we'll have cancer solved in the next couple of years. That's what that sounds like, right? Complete bait and switching under the wobbly notion of intelligence, right? And it's just infuriating, right? Now, it may turn out that there will be a breakthrough into the kind of intelligence that we're AGI, But that will just be lucky that you predicted it, just because you were lucky that you said it would be around the corner, not because of any principled reason to believe it, right? So again, large language models, they're morons, these large language models, okay? Now, the idea that by just scaling up some more and billion more parameters, we'll get something, maybe, I can't say we won't, but there's no reason to believe we will either. Any more that we're going to cure cancer in a year because we were so impressive with COVID vaccines.
You know, there's all this talk about artificial general intelligence or human level intelligence, et cetera, and how close we are to it with AI. But I don't think anyone can define what they mean as what is the target? What is this thing you're calling artificial general intelligence? What is this thing you're calling human level intelligence? How will we know when we got it? And that's part of the problem. We don't have a theory that tells us, that will tell us when AI has reached that point. Or even, as John said, you know, given certain abilities that we've seen in these systems, that now that means we're kind of on this continuum getting towards this greater general intelligent ability. So I think if we don't even know what the target is, we can't say how close we are to it.
I do want to allow Brendan to defend himself against the assault from my aggressive brother. and I might help you. But I would like to point out that, to Melanie's point, one of the problems is the Turing test. I mean, when Alan Turing was first struggling with this question of intelligence, what he did, and we're living with the legacy, is he said, I don't want a theory. What I'm going to do is come up with this observer-dependent criterion, and if you convince me, then you are, right? And so if you play chess, then you're intelligent. Or if you play Go, if you can solve this. And there is this interesting question, and it was a very interesting move, but it seems quite limiting. And I'm wondering, maybe to Brendan, do you think, I think we all agree here that it's quite context-dependent and function-dependent, obviously. But do you think there's a kind of limitation to this kind of Turing test way of doing things? Should there be, to Melanie's point, a more fundamental theory that we could gauge progress using?
Yeah, I mean, I personally would love there to be a deeper theory that we're gauging against. I mean, I think the goal, so like in AI, everyone complains about the goalposts moving, but I think this is both good and bad, right? So because we don't have a theory, you end up saying, well, what would be an observer-based test? And then as the law goes, right, once it's a measure that you're trying to test, it ceases being a good measure, right? Because then people in AI say, great, okay, that's what you want me to do. Now I'm going to hyper-focus on getting that goal by any means necessary. And then we end up not being truly happy with the result, right? And so that's because we don't have a great definition of it, you can't, it's hard to test any system. But so I would love there to be one, but I also, because it's such a multifaceted, interesting question, I find it hard to understand what that would be, but that's possibly a limitation of my own brain. I think to respond to the bait and switch point, I think to some extent that's right, right? I think, but I guess from my perspective, I think while it's folly to say all we need to do is scale up and we'll get there, I just think it's also somewhat weird to say that we're definitely not going to be able to do certain things with these methods, given I think we're just at a maximal uncertainty point, and we should really, like, one thing that is going to happen is people are going to try to push them to see where we end up, and then maybe once we get there, now we'll understand what is the next criterion we should aim for, whether that's a theory-based thing or whether that's the next observer criterion that we're missing in order to finally get a feel for what is it that we're really searching for when we say we want something that's generally intelligent.
Just on the Turing test, I'm actually a fan of the Turing test in terms of, you know, having now played with Melanie on GPT-3 and then with Blair's I played with Palm and broke it within minutes. So in other words, and that's basically a kind of Turing test. It's funny, if you, Stuart Russell, you know, one of the AI gurus, really doesn't like it and actually has suggested, deeply ironically, instead of a Turing test, just have a much more generic notion of intelligence, which is goal-directedness, right? Very similar to why bacteria are intelligent. Very similar to theories like Friston's and others, make it such a low common denominator, just talk about being goal-directed and in sort of out of, you know, avoid heat death and equilibrium, because it's really annoying if you get into the Turing test domain, because it's easy to be broken, even today. Whereas with specific things like chess or Go, yes, that's very impressive. So are spider webs very impressive and very intelligent. And what I'm telling you is the intelligence that goes into playing Go or chess is no different to the kind of intelligence that a spider is showing when it builds an elaborate, beautiful web. It's brittle, it's focused, it's subconscious, and it's flexible policies, and it's all very impressive. It's intelligent. But the Turing test stuff, I mean, Turing was kind of right. There was something weird about us, and then towards the end of his career, he sort of moved away from that. And so has the whole field, because it is a real challenge.
Can I just say something about spider web? it's actually a really fascinating extended phenotype that spiders use to either communicate with each other, communicate with their prey. They actually tune that the strength, and they pay attention to normal modes. And in a sense, they have this intuitive understanding of the physics of that structure, which is a little bit more mechanistic maybe than the artificial intelligence that you were referring to. But just a comment.
So let me shift quickly, because one of the areas I'm interested in is stupidity. And we all talk about intelligence in the hope that we would be thought of as intelligent. And if we talk about stupidity, there's the corresponding risk. But the first bridge towards talking about stupidity is ethics. And so all of these tests that are being performed are analytical, right? Whether it's language or... And we've all lived with ethics, and SFI has a big program on this that folks like Chris Moore work on, which is algorithmic justice, where we outsource decisions in the criminal justice systems to algorithms that are provisioned with racist data and so on. And I just want to talk a little bit about that other characteristic, which is, why is it humans have this incredible capability and yet ethically we're just so compromised? Anyone want to comment on ethics? No, you see.
I will. I mean, I think there are two different realms where this has become big, David, right? One is the whole notion of bounded rationality, right? Lots of people working, Tom Griffith, Sam Gershman, sort of trying to show why it is that certain irrationalities might have a certain rationality. Simon DeDeo, who's doing work on that. So there's a whole area about why is it that we can be so stupid even though we have this unique instrument, right? But that's one area. And then there's the notion of, you know, why are we so unethical even when we understand the ethical principles when we're confronted with them? And the best example of that is work done by, I'm blanking on his name right now. He's a philosopher who did a very interesting experiment. He wanted to see whether philosophers who taught ethics were any more ethical in their everyday life than anyone else. Eric Swissgable, right. And unfortunately, yes, the terribly disappointing result was that philosophers of ethics were no more ethical in their everyday life than non-philosophers of ethics. Okay, now, do with that what you want, but the one thing that is clear is that when Eric did this work, right, and we had him, I've spoken to him about it, and I'm embarrassed I forgot his name, is it's not that they didn't understand the reasoning behind the ethical principles, to David's point. They did. They can be confronted and logically explain the ethical principles, but they don't act by them, and then that leaks into a kind of cousin of bounded rationality, which is the whole system one, system two, dual systems world, right? Which is that you have all these subconscious control policies, habits, competing Isaiah Berlin-like incommensurables, and they win out over your ability to reason the ethical principles from first principles. And it gets to your point about skill. Life is a skill where you automatize as much as you can so you don't have to think about anything. right? And most people, including philosophers, are running on a kind of life autopilot. Life is a skill, and they don't, if they can, they avoid having to ever go back to first ethical principles.
Anyone else? Ethics?
I think I'm not someone who studied this, so this is me talking from a position of naivety, but I would guess that part of it is that humans end up being very good at being goal-driven, and we're also very embraced by culture, right? And so if you then get put in some system where there's a nice benefit to winning, and then everyone around you agrees that winning is the important thing, it's very easy to forget everything else, and it's very easy to abandon things that aren't that. And I think, and then because we're also, for many of us, we're really embedded in culture, really don't, at least me personally, really don't want to let my teammates down. It's then very hard to take that step back and say, wait a minute, let's not try to win. Let's be okay with losing because we want to maintain this. And then when somebody else ends up winning, you then feel bad or whatever, right? And I think this kind of, it's really hard to maintain cultures of ethics when you're also embedded in systems that want to win. And I think especially with AI research, we need to be very careful about this going forward, is trying to make sure that we're making these systems kind of, I don't know how, it's hard to do this, but trying to keep this in mind is we're not pushing forward blindly as fast as we can, instead that we're trying to make sure that we're keeping them safe and keeping things ethical so that we don't, yeah, end up unleashing a whole bunch of things that we don't want unleashed.
I think, you know, clearly, as John said, we're not rational. We have bounded rationality, and it's quite bounded. And we have lots of conflicting goals. It's not like we have a single objective function that we're following. We have lots of conflicting goals. You know, I want to be healthy, but I also want to eat chocolate cake. I want to be nice to everyone, and yet John might say something to insult me, and I might want to punch him. And, you know, these things are fighting.
You can do it.
Yeah. They're constantly fighting inside us, and the result is that we can think one thing and do another thing. Happens all the time, you know, believe something and do something that completely contradicts that. Now, I think the fantasy of artificial intelligence is that we're going to get something like human-like intelligence, but without all of that messiness, without all of that nasty, you know, mean conflict, you know, what do you call it, cognitive dissonance that's inside us. And I'm not convinced at all that you can have one without the other. So that's a question for a theory of intelligence. Could you have that one without the other?
I'm going to do one more question, then I open it up, which is understanding. And, you know, I was talking to Ted earlier about quantum mechanics after our conversation this morning. And this was one of those domains where the mathematical theory works, but the intuition is not there. And there's a very famous quote in quantum mechanics, which is, shut up and calculate. Don't expect it to be intuitive. So that's fundamental physics. Then you've got the world that Brendan lives in very much, and that Melanie has written a great deal about, which is these machines. And they also perform in particular functions. And they have this shut up and calculate property because we don't know how they work either. And yet, to be ethical, we need to understand. And I just want to quickly ask everyone the very difficult question of what we think we mean by understanding. Do we have any insight into what that means to have understanding? All right, you look like you're really keen to answer
yes.
that question.
I'm a little bit more like the Feynman quote, mm-hmm. where I need to build it to understand. I do think that in some way, having artificial intelligence, reinforcement learning, whatever it is, solving a problem, that's a really big hope that there is actually some kind of mechanism behind it. It's in some cases. So, you know, protein folding and all these sort of things. But yeah, I feel like if we have a mechanistic understanding of a problem, then we can make predictions. We can make testable predictions. We can test them with organisms, with living systems. And yeah, I think it's just really important.
Man, anyone's yeah.
So Chris Kempis gave a great example in the previous talk where he showed the view of the universe, you know, or the solar system. There was Ptolemy who had all these hypercycles, and then there was Kepler who figured out elliptical orbits, and then there was Newton who figured out the laws of gravity. And I think we have a sense that Newton's view really increased the understanding of what was happening in the universe. And I think these kinds of mechanistic models, you know, they all made predictions, right? But Newton's had something very, you know, some notion of cause to it, some notion that there was a cause, this thing called gravity that's causing the planets to orbit in some way. I think this kind of causal model is something that we humans and other animals probably can get inside our heads and allow us to not only predict things, but to abstract them, to say, wait, well, they're all going to work in different situations. And David and I just wrote a paper about this, whether the question about these AI models and to whether they actually understand, could we say that there are different modes of understanding? There's an understanding that has to do with these more compact mechanistic models of the world, or can you also have another kind of understanding, which is just having a lot of statistical information about what letter goes after another letter, as Brendan explained? I don't know. I don't want to call that other thing understanding, but maybe I'm going to be forced to if it performs well enough.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, I'm very much, I've said this to David, I believe in many intelligences, but understanding of the kind that we're talking about when we talk about science is the human version of intelligence, okay? And we're just going to give it another name, then we'll just kick the can down the road and come up with a third word. This Feynman quote gets on my nerves as well. Build it. Feynman actually, and this is where he's less quoted, actually speaks about how you have to have this special thing in his lectures on physics. He talks about this intuition where you can intuit what the equations will do without having to go through the derivation. And he was actually sort of paraphrasing Dirac, who said exactly the same thing. And then there were very similar statements from Einstein and Schrodinger about the ability to visualize, intuit. And there's a whole field about intuition in the philosophy of mathematics. Okay, there is somebody called Hank Direct who's written a book called Understanding, Scientific Understanding, where he sort of goes into this and says that human, and getting to your point, human understanding is a skill. You're only going to do well within your domain where you've become skilled to do that thing that Dirac and Feynman were talking about. And what Hank Dirac says is that the understanding in science is the ability to have an intuitive, compressed theory about a phenomenon that you can then skillfully work with. So and David wrote a piece about science versus prediction. So understanding is a peculiar human ability to come up with compact, compressed, intuitively useful theories that come between you and the phenomenon so that you can actually engage with it, communicate about it, and experiment on it. Okay. That is something that humans do. I'm not aware of any animals doing scientific experiments, last time I checked. Okay, so science is a good microcosm for the kind of understanding and the kind of inference that we're good at doing that leads to this and notions of intuition. You know, there are these ideas, you know, Zena can talk about them, about where those come from. But there are theories of understanding. You can operationalize them, but what you find when you do it is it's strictly human.
Yeah, I agree with this. I agree with this definition of understanding that's about compressed representations and being able to abstract them. Where I think it gets a lot squirrely, and I think based on what you said, you'd agree with this, is that a lot of it comes to like understanding from who and about what, and the sense that, so we organized a thing on the meaning of understanding a couple of years ago, and well, one person I brought was the person who solved checkers, right? So we know the optimal way to play checkers now, and that's a thing that's known. Or similarly, if we asked AlphaZero, why did you play a stone at location 10, 11? Well, maybe AlphaZero's answer is, well, if I show you this whole move tree for the next 100 moves, it's like the highest probability of winning. And on the one hand, maybe that's understanding because it's like an effective system, but certainly I, as a non-expert Go player, don't gain anything from that tree. I don't feel like I understand what the move is, but maybe it does. But on the other hand, if I were a professional Go player, maybe 98 of those moves are fairly obvious, and actually, by seeing this one move that I missed, now I, as a professional Go player, understand why that's there. And I think this is where understanding gets really squirrely, and even when you want to understand why somebody did something, oftentimes we're really good at constructing English language reasons for why that's true. But is that, in many cases, it's very hard to tell, is that really why it's true? And even when I'm talking about myself as to why I did something, is that really why I did it? Maybe like part of me thinks that's true and part of me doesn't. And so I think understanding also ends up being really context dependent in lots of places. And on the one hand, I think we have things like gravitation, where everybody can basically understand gravitation if you want, and has a lot of predictive power about a lot of things. But it happens to be extremely convenient that the equation is so simple. And for much more complicated phenomena like intelligence, I think it's gonna be very hard to, I would predict that it's gonna be very hard to come up with something that says, oh, I understand why intelligence emerges, because it's such a complex thing, and I don't think there's really any reason to believe such a compressed, nice representation exists.
So thank you very much. But are there any questions out there in the world? I'll allow you to.
Hi. I heard John use the word subconsciously related to a AI doing his thing. Yeah. What I'm missing in the whole discussion is consciousness as a characteristic feature of human and some animals, intelligence. I haven't heard apart from subconscious. Thank you.
No, I mean, you know, people, I mean, a position that I'm taking on this, and I'm developing it, so, is that most intelligent behavior is subconscious. And I can show you all sorts of very intelligent behavior that you engage in that you have no idea that you're doing those computations, and you're very grateful that you do, right? Now, consciousness is not a computation. It's a little bit like pain. You know it's happening to you, right? And I think where consciousness becomes inevitable, and it's called in the animal behavior literature reflective consciousness. In other words, I am now paying attention to my thinking, to my computation. Some people call it metacognition. And you can induce metacognition with electrodes in the prefrontal cortex of humans, actually. So consciousness, to me, operationally, is a little bit like working memory. It's when you bring the representation comes online like a pane, and then you operate on it overtly, Kahneman's sort of system two. And it's that we're good at. We can actually look at our computations and our operations and our representations and fiddle with them. Like, you know, the most famous one is, you know, Metzler and Shepard's mental rotation, right? You can take an object and you can mentally rotate it in your head. The only way you can do that mental rotation is you imagine that object, you're overtly conscious of it in your head, and you start to operate on it and rotate it, okay? Now, I looked once in the literature if there's any mental rotation experiments that work in non-human primates, and no. Okay, so operationally, it's to be able to actually look at your representation in a meta way, operate on it, and that's a superpower that we have.
Thank you. I'd like to pose a two-part question to the whole panel. In consideration of the nature of intelligence, and in consideration more specifically of the discontinuity between human intelligence and other species' intelligence, especially our ape ancestors, what you think about philosopher Terence McKenna's hypothesis of the stoned ape, meaning that in some at some time in our ancient human evolutionary history, that our deepest ape ancestors at some point certainly began eating psilocybin mushrooms, and that this could be a catalyst for that discontinuity, which has resulted in part of this symbolic cognition we have. That's the first part of the question. The second part of the question is whoever answers, have you personally had a direct experience of a medium to high dose of psilocybin?
So I can answer the second question by saying I don't need it. but I will not answer the first question. Does someone else actually have something to say about that? I don't.
I feel bad for you because, you know, it's true that psychedelics are all the rage, and there are some interesting features about psychedelics when it comes to metacognition and ideas about it. But I do think there's a distinction to be made between an origin story, which I can't comment on at all. I just don't know that origin story, versus why that would lead to the divergence, the discontinuity we're talking about. I just don't know.
Hi. This is just kind of a fun question, and hopefully you don't turn it down like the last. But at the beginning of the conversation, you started with saying that we don't know what to do with intelligence. And I'm just curious what you think, if it's even possible, far out in the future, could we ever have AI-assisted nirvana or increase the quality of life for people with complementary intelligence?
I mean, I'll just do a quick, I'm sure people have thoughts on that. I've worked on this question, actually. I call this exbodiment, not embodiment, which is something else. And in fact, that's the history of human civilization. It's not AI, it's the abacus or the astrolabe or mathematical notation. These have done exactly that. So these are these outsourced inferential systems, and AI is just the latest. And so in that sense, I think the history of civilization, of technology, period, has had that property, not always good, not nirvana. I think, to Melanie's point, just as often negative as positive, and perhaps psilocybin actually fits into that if it were suitably used. But I wouldn't make that distinction with AI. I think that's actually a general property of technologies. I don't know if other people.
Yeah, I totally agree with David. I think that any technology, and AI is one of them, can help our quality of life. You know, imagine driving without GPS, right? People used to do it. it was a lot harder, and you got lost more often. But it also has some negative effects on us. You know, we've now kind of lost our ability to read maps. At least my kids have, you know, because they've never used them. And trusting these systems too much can also lead you into dealing with bad effects of taking their advice when it's non-commonsensical.
I'll just say that, I think yes. When you look at Dolly, I mean, you can imagine some sort of Dolly variant that becomes your own AI orgasmatron. Yeah, Dolly is this AI that can now basically be prompted to draw for you. For those who haven't seen it, it's all over the internet. This ability to just have images drawn to verbal prompts. Okay, as I said, I think TikTok. That's AI-based, and it's become a complete orgasmatron. People lose hours on it, right? And they just keep flipping, right? So, yes, I don't know if TikTok should be considered nirvana, but it's certainly an externalized AI-based algorithmic orgasmatron. It is, right? So I think, yeah, we'll get there. Now you have to ask yourselves whether you want it or not.
Hello. Hi, I'm Zandi. I have... like my consciousness friend over there, not heard the word emotion or emotional be used at all. And, you know, there's this concept of emotional intelligence. Maybe it's mostly used in, like, business academic literature, you know, about self-awareness, self-improvement. But to me, the most interesting part of it is the way we relate to one another and understanding the ways that we relate to one another. And I'd love to know what you guys think about emotional intelligence and the neuroscience of it, and how much your AI work or machine learning work can help us with that, because I kind of think it's important.
You know, there is Howard Gardner is responsible for coming up this idea of emotional intelligence and all these different forms of intelligence. I'm afraid to say that there's very little good scientific evidence for anything like emotional intelligence. It's one of these things that's become a buzzword, but actually if you go and look for any serious neuroscience, no. Now, does that mean that we shouldn't be very, very concerned about emotion and the neuroscience of emotion and how it interfaces with intelligence? Absolutely. Right? And, you know, people like Luis Pessoa, he's a neuroscientist at the University of Maryland, has done lots of work on the intersection of the emotional system and the cognitive system. So that's a very interesting interaction. You know, it's beyond what we can talk about now. But I think that that conversation should be had outside this buzzword of emotional intelligence.
People in artificial intelligence often want to ignore the idea of emotion as being relevant to intelligence because, you know, how are we going to make a machine have emotions? So they sort of see emotions as a negative thing that we can transcend with artificial intelligence. It's not going to, you know, it's part of this whole rationality idea. But I think John's right that emotions have a huge impact on everything we do, and we don't understand very well that impact. And I think it's going to be a really big part of untangling what we mean by intelligence in general.
I would add, I also personally am nervous about AI systems that promise to bring that, in the sense that I think lots of places, especially where you want emotional support, are extremely context dependent, and AIs today aren't good at sort of holistically taking in context. Like, they might be good at taking in local context and responding to what you said two sentences ago and saying something. And in particular, if you look at these large language models, they all seem to be huge people pleasers, in the sense that you say, like, oh, I think you're a squirrel. Are you a squirrel? And it says, why, yes, I am a squirrel. Let's talk about squirrel things. And that's some kind of emotion, and it's some kind of personality, but it's not a very wide one, and it's not the breadth that we see. And so I think, and more specifically, if you're going to start giving advice to people, and especially on really sensitive topics, you need to really understand the context of someone, and even human to human, where we share so much shared background just as humans, and then if we both grew up in the US, we might even share a lot more context that we always already take for granted, which an AI is going to be totally foreign to. And so I think maybe in some distant future these systems could be helpful, but I guess I'm fairly nervous about anything that promises that today or promises that in the next couple of years, just because for humans, it's just so difficult to take in the right context to provide the right advice.
I know, Zen, you've had your hand up for so long. You can either shout it out and I'll repeat it if you don't have a mic, but oh, the mic's coming, so.
Thanks. So one of the ways that these large language models reveal their lack of intelligence is when they don't tell the truth, they lie, or they're incoherent. They'll say, you know, incoherent about space or time. And so I guess my question is whether a theory of intelligence, like this discussion is about, depends upon a theory of other things, like a theory of truth or a theory of time, as we were talking about earlier in the day, or a theory of space. And can we have a theory of intelligence which is not predicated on fully understanding these base concepts independently?
Yeah, so this was the Lakoff thing approach, that it's one of the arguments in favor of embodiment, that you need a sense of spatial being embedded in the physical world, and without a sense of an intuitive physics, there can be no consequent analytical intelligence. But I don't know if that's gone anywhere. I mean, that sort of died. What's your sense?
I don't think it's died. I think that you know, there's this idea of, in psychology, it's a controversial idea that babies are born with this an innate sense of objects, that the world is carved into objects, that there is space and space has certain kind of properties, and you know that there are things that are agents that have goals, and there's things that are not agents, like, you know, tables and chairs and rocks and so on. And this is something that I think, you know, might help in a theory of intelligence, is if we can determine, are these things innate? Are these things actually essential for building the kinds of concepts that intelligence requires? So I'm sympathetic to that view.
Yeah, I mean, it's a huge area. I mean, poor old Doug Lanat, right, who's been trying to assemble the core primitives of knowledge that is needed, up, down, you know, big, small, right? And, you know, you can go all the way back to Jerry Fodor, who actually said that you, at some point, you had to actually have concepts already inside you, right? And then people very recently, like Stephen Piantedosi, you know, at Berkeley, have tried to find a way to get hold of some of those conceptual and knowledge primitives through some grounding mechanism without having to presuppose them. So it's still a huge issue, is where do these core things like up, down, big, small, far, near. And I don't think it's that controversial. Kids are born with those, right? I don't actually think it is controversial.
It is.
Yeah, I know, but I just find one side far more convincing than the other. But I'm just saying that it's a controversy, and we can decide who we believe, but it's an issue where there's no doubt that you're going to have to get them from somewhere, right? And that is a huge mystery still.
So this, you work on this topic, then. What do you think?
Well, I mean, I think you have to have some things innate. I mean, just as an inductive bias, otherwise you can't learn. But my question was less about that. It was more around, can we have a theory of intelligence without a theory of truth?
Of non-human intelligence, you can, yes.
Well, let's say of human intelligence.
It's very important, though, right? In other words, I don't think we're going to have a total theory, because we're going to have theories of intelligence, and we're going to have this problem that we're having this conversation about truth. So are you asking, do we need a theory of human intelligence with truth in it, or a theory of general intelligence?
I'm not sure. I mean, I think, even if we're restricted to the human case, again, to the kind of the theme of the discussion, it just seems to me that there are many, like, intelligence as a concept is fraught. Maybe it's an umbrella concept, but the ways in which we identify systems as being non-intelligent is because they violate some intuitive notion about, for example, truth. And we haven't identified that concept in a fully formed out way. And so I wonder whether it's almost like we're trying to solve a harder problem than we need to at this particular point in time.
So, and let give you the last word to you, because I think it's a great question. And thank you very much, all the panelists. Thank you very much for participating. Much appreciated.